Welcome, everyone, to this Washington History Seminar. Welcome to the Wilson Center. Eric Arneson, my co-chair, and I are delighted to have so many of you here on this beautiful, beautiful spring day. And I think the initial RSVP list took a little bit of a hit when the temperatures hit above 80 degrees. But we're happy to have you here for today's talk on Cuba and American history with Ada Ferrer. Eric will introduce her in just a minute. Let me just say, as always, thanks to our partners at the National History Center, Dane Kennedy, the president, and Amanda Muniz, the associate president, to my staff, Piet Bierstecker, in the back, who helps put the logistics in place, get us all organized for our weekly seminar. As always, we thank our funders, especially the Society of Historians of American Foreign Relations, for generously supporting this event, as well as a number of anonymous donors. And as Eric and I like to say, we're always on the lookout for fresh support. So please feel free to join that list of named or unnamed donors. We also like to thank the History Department of George Washington University for its support. And I think that's it. Yeah. And yes, internally, thank you. Internally, our Latin America program is sponsoring this event. Cindy Arnson is the director. I don't know if Cindy's here. Will join us, but delighted to do this. And I think some of you have gotten notice of this event through the Latin American mailing list. So welcome to all of you. And with that, over to Eric for our introduction.
Thank you, Christian, and thank you all for coming out on this beautiful day. It's my pleasure to introduce our speaker this afternoon. Ada Ferrer is professor of history and Latin American and Caribbean studies at New York University. She is the author of two award-winning books, Insurgent Cuba, Race, Nation, and Revolution, 1868-1898, which was published by the University of North Carolina Press in 1999, and most recently, Freedom's Mirror, Cuba and Haiti in the Age of Revolution, published by Cambridge University Press in 2014. That book won not one, not two, but three prizes from the American Historical Association, as well as the Frederick Douglass Book Prize from the Gilder Lehman Center for the Study of Slavery, Abolition, and Resistance. And she is currently writing a history of Cuba that will be published by Scribner. And today, she will be speaking on Cuba and American history.
All right, well, I'll begin by echoing the thanks you've already heard and thank Eric and Christian and the Washington History Seminar, the National History Center, GW, the Wilson Center, and all of you for coming out this afternoon. When Amanda first emailed me to invite me to do one of these Washington seminars, she suggested that I speak on my most recent book, which is, as Eric just said, Freedom's Mirror, Cuba and Haiti in the Age of Revolution. And I was happy to do that, but as the time grew near and we saw everything that had been happening between Cuba and the U.S. in the last month, we decided that it might be more interesting to talk about something historians rarely get to talk about, which is history being made in the moment. So we stepped back, and I just thought I'd talk about the current moment between Cuba and the U.S. and the current rapprochement, and think about it as a historian. How might historians approach this new moment in Cuba-U.S. relations? So that's what I'll be talking about today. Now, I was very fortunate to have been in Havana last month when Barack Obama was there making history. As we all know, Obama made history by being the first American president to travel to the island since the Cuban Revolution of 1959, and only the second ever American president to travel to Cuba since Cuban independence. The first, as you probably know, was Calvin Coolidge in 1928. Obama's trip was the culmination, and I should say culmination so far, of a longer process of re-encounter between Cuba and the U.S. that began publicly on December 17, 2014, when both Obama and Raul Castro announced simultaneously that they were embarking on a path of normalizing relations between the two countries. The path taken since that date has produced other historic firsts in the last 15 months. For the first time since 1960, Cuba opened an embassy in D.C. The U.S. did the same in Havana. For the first time since 1961, U.S. companies are operating in Cuba. And I don't know how many of you know, but there's an American tractor company now in Cuba. Carnival Cruise Lines is operating in Cuba. Starwood Hotels just signed a contract to manage three state-owned Cuban hotels. For the first time in over 50 years, the countries have resumed direct postal service. New York Times journalist Damian Cave recently joked that writing about Cuba-U.S. relations in the present makes one wish for some kind of keyboard shortcut for the phrase, for the first time in over 50 years. While Obama's visit often felt historic, as I watched and talked about it with Cubans in their homes and on the streets, I realized that it's much harder. It felt historic when I was there talking to people. But I'm a historian, and I know that it is much harder to know what the trip and what Obama's efforts regarding Cuba more generally will mean for the future of Cuba-U.S. relations. Too much remains uncertain. Obama will soon leave office, as we all know, and we don't know what the next president in U.S. Congress will do. In Cuba, meanwhile, the main theme of the recent Communist Party Congress earlier this month was continuity as much, or indeed even more, than change. Raul, who has so far been an architect of and an eager participant in the changes underway, will himself leave office in 2018. And while the informal response to Obama seems to have been overwhelmingly positive, the official press in Cuba also launched a counteroffensive immediately after his departure. At a fundamental level, the official critics in Cuba took issue with the historic nature of Obama's trip. In this view, Obama's trip was important, but it was just a moment, and one that both American politics and the Cuban public might soon render irrelevant. In the words of one Cuban critic, quote, "Obama is important in the brief scene of the grand drama in which he's been relegated to act. He might be remembered if he acts well, or he might continue on to the oblivion to which history will subject him," end quote. Here, the contrast with another seminal invocation of history couldn't be greater. In 1953, after Fidel Castro stormed the barracks at Moncada, he defended himself in the trial by staking a claim to history's vindication, that everyone inside of Cuba remembers well, and that many outside of Cuba know as well. At the end of his trial for the invasion of the Moncada barracks, he famously ended his speech in his own self-defense by saying, "Condemn me if you wish, history will absolve me." And that's just the speech was published and circulated, and that's the cover of the book at the time. "Condemn me if you wish, but history will absolve me." So in the context of Obama's visit, critics seem to suggest that history would remember and vindicate Fidel. Meanwhile, it would likely forget Obama. Fidel himself seemed to agree with this assessment. Sounding like a man close to the end of his life, Fidel reflected on this after Obama's departure. He wrote in the official national newspaper Granma, quote, "The first thing to consider is that our lives are but a fraction of a historical second, and that humans tend to overvalue their role in history," end quote. It's a surprising quote coming from Fidel Castro, I think. But he meant it in relation to Obama. So while Obama and much of the world went on about the historic nature of the trip, the official Cuban media has sought to minimize the historic importance of both the trip and the person. Indeed, Obama's trip may have also revealed a more fundamental difference in both sides' treatment of history writ large. One might even say that the stakes in this moment of rapprochement express themselves through different visions of or different relationships with history. Consider, for example, the speech that Obama gave at the Gran Teatro Alicia Alonso in Havana on March 22nd. The speech was televised live and in its entirety on Cuban television. In the speech, Obama spoke briefly of the history of pre-revolutionary Cuba in terms not entirely unlike those used by the Cuban Revolution itself. He spoke of a republic that the U.S. treated quote, as something to exploit, ignoring poverty and enabling corruption, end quote. Before 1959, in other words, Cuba was a country that needed a revolution. In some ways, what he did in that speech was treat the Cuban Revolution as something legitimate. And to think of an American president doing that is really remarkable. And I think even people who, you know, knew he was going and were getting ready for his speech couldn't or didn't, for the most part, foresee that that is what he would do, what he would do in the speech. He even compared the Cuban Revolution at one point implicitly to the American Revolutionary War of Independence. He spoke about positive achievements of the revolution. I think that that was surprised many people inside and outside of Cuba. And he went on in the speech and said, quote, since 1959, we've been shadow boxers in this battle of geopolitics and personalities. And then he finished the thought by saying, quote, I know the history, but I refuse to be trapped by it. I know the history, but I refuse to be trapped by it. In the same vein, towards the end of the speech, he declared, quote, the history of the United States and Cuba encompasses revolution and conflict, struggle and sacrifice, retribution, and now reconciliation. It is time now for us to leave the past behind. It is time for us to look forward to the future together. And then he concluded, we can make this journey as friends and as neighbors and as family together, end quote. Fidel Castro is known for making very, very long speeches, but hidden in them are often pithy and searing lines. And in his reflections on Obama's speech, published in Granma just a few days after Obama left, the Fidel regularly, although he has slowed down in recent years, publishes reflections that are always appear on page 2 of the official Cuban state paper. And you see that it says you see the title of the reflection on Obama. It's called Brother Obama. And it was published on March 28th, I believe. Anyway, in this reflection, Fidel provided one such pithy line in response to the particular line of Obama's that I just read. Fidel quoted that line in the line of Obama's verbatim, the line about leaving the past behind and journeying forward as friends and family. And then Fidel added in his own voice, quote, it is assumed that each of us ran the risk of a heart attack on hearing these words spoken by the President of the United States, end quote. Importantly, in many of the Cuban critiques of the speech that I have read, it is this particular notion of leaving history behind that has served as a touchstone for criticism, as encapsulating a kind of essential difference between the two countries as they re-encounter each other after more than half a century. In this new encounter between the two countries, you have on one side a people bombarded with historical, patriotic images and rhetoric. Everywhere there are billboards that blend images and words of 19th century patriots with those of contemporary political figures. In short, in Cuba, you have a vision of the present that since 1959 has linked the legitimacy of modern political projects with historic 19th century struggles for sovereignty. On the other side, you have an American public generally unaware of that history. Americans tend to know little about the history of Cuba before the revolution, and they treat Cuba after the revolution as a kind of timeless place, a place where nothing much happens. We can take as an example of this much of the U.S. coverage during the Obama visit, and if you'll just bear with me, I wanted to just play something from a...
Rather.
Cuba is a nation frozen in time.
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 The closest thing to time travel.
An island frozen in time.
Stuck in a time warp. Thousands of vintage American cars still...
Get the idea. It goes on, but it was a little louder than I thought. Let me go back to. Okay. So there you have it, for the U.S., Cuba as an island out of time, an island second time, an island where history happened at a different kind of pace, if it happened at all. Almost as if by disposition, Obama, as president of that United States, proudly announced that he was relegating history to the margins and facing forward to the future. Americans hear in Obama's words a conciliatory, even optimistic gesture. Fidel, meanwhile, treats it as ludicrous enough to provoke bodily harm, and the official Cuban media bristles. Here you have a perfect encapsulation of a kind of impasse. And in that encounter between Cuban and American leaders, as maybe between Cuban citizens and American tourists, it is not always clear who is lecturing whom or whether each of them, either of them, is capable of seeing the other through something other than naive faith or recalcitrant suspicion. That may simply be what happens when the curtain begins to lift after more than a half century of formal diplomatic isolation, itself originally imposed on two countries intimately aware of each other for more than 100 years before that. In this re-encounter between the two countries, perhaps as in all moments of profound change, history itself is up for grabs. For both countries, the nature of the historic ties between Cuba and the U.S. is now an obligatory subject of interpretation and reinterpretation. What is the nature of the relationship historically, in the present, going forward? The histories overlap, certainly, but to what extent is there a shared vision of that history? As an aside, I thought it was interesting when I was in Cuba that in the days leading up to Obama's arrival, the national TV broadcast several programs that were meant to kind of highlight close historic ties between Cuba and the U.S. So, for example, they profiled several Americans with deep connections to Cuba. One program was on Ernest Hemingway, unsurprisingly. Another program was on a man named Henry Reeve. I don't know how many of you have ever heard of Henry Reeve here. He's very popular and well-known in Cuba. He's actually a Brooklyn-born American who fought and died in Cuba's first war of independence against Spain. And there was a profile of him a night or two before Obama's arrival. And then on the eve of Obama's arrival, the national newscast did a short biographical sketch of Obama. And there, the focus was very, very positive. The story was presented as a typical American story, and the focus was on Obama as someone of humble origins who had risen by, you know, hard work and intelligence to become a, you know, to go to college, become a community organizer, lawyer, first president of the Harvard Law Review, et cetera, et cetera. All that was in the profile that aired the night before he landed. And in a way, the casting Obama's story as a very typical American story seemed to jettison the kind of invective and vitriol that of old. So what is this shared history between Cuba and the U.S.? It is one, as the title of Lupedes's book, suggests, it is a relationship of singular intimacy. But like all intimacy, perhaps, it is also a relationship laden with struggles over power, boundaries, and recognition. So let us look very briefly at the 200-year history of U.S.-Cuban relations in just a few minutes. The intimacy between Cuba and the U.S. stretches back over more than two centuries. And today, I think it is especially important to remember that it is an intimacy that runs in both directions. The U.S., of course, has been an overwhelming presence in Cuban history. But few Americans have likely considered the significance of Cuba for the United States at the moment of the latter's birth. When the 13 colonies severed ties with Britain, they also lost their access to other British colonies, including the wealthy sugar islands of the Caribbean. Where were the former American colonists supposed to get their sugar, and to whom would they sell their flour and cheese? The Spanish colony of Cuba was one obvious and important answer. Even as Cuba became a vital trading partner at a critical moment in the history of the new United States, the boundaries of the new American Republic pushed up against and increasingly absorbed Spanish territory in Louisiana, Florida, Alabama, all territories governed and administered by authorities in Havana, and sometimes guarded by militias from Havana. The ever-expanding map of the United States was drawn and redrawn in negotiations with Spanish Havana. Later, Southerners would look to Cuba as a potential new slave state, as a way to buttress the power of both slavery and the South. After one Spanish territories in Florida and Texas joined the United States in 1845, the annexation of Cuba seemed imminent. Jane McManus Casnow, a wealthy Texas settler, journalist, and vocal member of the Buy Cuba lobby, insisted that Cubans were, quote, wild for annexation to the U.S., end quote. In Washington, Secretary of State James Buchanan, later the 15th president of the U.S., wrote to his successor in 1849, quote, Cuba is already ours. I feel it in my fingers' ends, end quote. In 1898, American intervention in Cuba's third and final war against Spain resulted in the Spanish-American War and helped produce two of the most important developments in U.S. history in this period. First, the reconciliation of North and South after decades of disunion, and second, the emergence of the U.S. as an imperial power on the world stage. In some ways, then, we might even say that the beginning of the American century happened in Cuba. Cuban independence was achieved at the close of the Spanish-American War. The end of some 400 years of Spanish rule was ritually observed at noon on January 1, 1899, with the synchronized lowering of every Spanish flag on the island. But the flag that was raised in its place was not a Cuban flag, but an American one. And you can't really see it. It's the thing that sticks out on the right, just below the bottom of the tower. It's not a very clear picture, I realized after I put it up there. The flag raised in its place was not a Cuban flag, but an American one, signaling the start of a full-fledged military occupation that would last for 4 years. Importantly, however, the Cuban flag not flown that January morning had actually been designed and flown for the first time by Cuban exiles in the United States decades earlier. The first independent Cuban newspaper was published in Philadelphia. The Cuban national anthem was composed in the U.S., and the first national novel was written in New York. Cuba's most famous patriot and writer, José Martí, spent more of his adult life in the U.S. than in Cuba. And the largest memorial service for Cuba's most important military hero, Antonio Maceo, the Afro-Cuban general, was held at Cooper Union in New York. And in one of the clearest signs of the messy entanglements of empire, the first president of independent Cuba was also an American citizen, Tomás Estrada Palma. For decades, his statue adorned the beginning of Avenida de los Presidentes, Avenue of the Presidents, also known as G, where it meets the Malecón, the beautiful seawall. Today, if one tries to visit the monument to the first Cuban president, however, one would find only the statue's shoes on the pedestal. The rest of him was taken down in the first months of Fidel Castro's revolution in 1959. A few blocks away, the large eagle atop the monument to the USS Maine was also demolished in the political demonstrations of the early Cuban Revolution. The history of American empire then, and also of the repudiation of American empire, is written into the very streetscapes of Havana. Clearly, undeniably, the histories of the two countries are closely linked and overlapping. In spite of that, or more likely because of it, there is no shared vision of that history, however. From the beginning of the formal U.S. intervention in Cuba in 1898, American politicians tended to believe that Cubans owed the U.S. a debt of gratitude. Many Cubans beg to differ. Cuba does not owe its independence to the U.S., was the telling title of one important book published in Havana in 1950. It's there in Spanish. It's not very clear. Cuba no debe su independencia a los Estados Unidos. That's the title of the book by one of the most prominent historians of Cuba in the 20th century. Alongside that American presumption and Cuban resentment, however, existed dense networks of human contact forged over decades by people of all kinds in both countries. Americans traveled to Cuba regularly to drink during Prohibition in the States, to buy land and cigars, to convert people to Protestantism, to forge networks of black solidarity, to honeymoon, to gamble, and to spring train before Jackie Robinson integrated American Major League Baseball. Cubans traveled the other way as well, to study at Harvard and Tuskegee, to shop in Miami, to play baseball in the American Negro Leagues, to escape dictators, and to view the falls at Niagara, which were made famous by Cuba's most famous writer, José Martí. Americans listened to Cuban music, and Cubans watched American movies. Americans bought Cuban sugar. Cubans bought American appliances. Actually, Cubans bought just about everything from the U.S. in the period before the revolution. And then all that changed, not overnight exactly, but almost. When Fidel Castro was organizing and fighting his revolution against the dictator Fulgencio Batista, few could have foreseen the drastic realignment that was about to take place. But within 2 years of the revolutionary seizing power in January 1959, the two countries would be at a veritable war. The new Cuban government nationalized American companies, and Cubans marched to the Malecón in mock funerals, in which the coffins bearing names such as Esso, today Exxon, and United Fruit were ceremoniously thrown into the Atlantic Ocean. During the Bay of Pigs invasion, American planes attacked Cuban airstrips, and American forces composed of Cuban exiles invaded, only to be captured and eventually returned to the U.S. in exchange for medicine and baby food, hence the famous Cuban lema or slogan of mercenarios por compotas, mercenaries for baby food. Within 2 years, Cuba had gone from being a client state of the United States to a staunch ally of its avowed enemy. Now Cuban sugar went to the Soviet Union, and oil and machinery that would have once come from the U.S. came from there as well. Embassies were closed and travel forbidden. In October 1962, for the only time in history, the U.S. faced nuclear warheads pointed in its direction from within striking distance. Battle lines had not only been drawn, but also barricaded and mined. The exigencies of the Cold War meant that for decades, Americans understood Cuba primarily as a small, if dangerous, and proximate satellite of the Soviet Union. Yet its role in the global Cold War notwithstanding, the Cuban Revolution of 1959 was at its core a nationalist revolution. When a bearded Fidel Castro left the mountains of eastern Cuba to begin the rebel march toward Havana in late 1958, he and his companions consciously chose to follow the same routes taken by 19th century patriots during the final war of independence against Spain. Once in power in the 1960s, Fidel spoke of 100 years of struggle, 100 años de lucha, from the First War of Independence in 1868 to the battle against the U.S. in the present. And here you see, on the left is a Cuban postage stamp. That's Antonio Maceo, the Afro-Cuban general there. And you can see, I don't know if you can read it in the back, the bottom says 1968, 100 años de lucha, 100 years of struggle. And next to it is a record, an album cover of music. And the same with the exact same words. And then the figures are, you've got obviously Che and Camilo Cienfuegos, very important revolutionaries in the 59 revolution, but then you also have Jose Martí, Antonio Maceo, Máximo Gómez, more 19th century patriots of the and heroes of the wars of independence. In the 1990s, after the loss of Soviet assistance, the decision to stay the course of socialism was also explained with repeated reference to the island's historic struggles for sovereignty in the 19th century. And so when I first started traveling to Cuba in the early 90s, which is obviously when the Soviet Union is collapsing, the billboards were everywhere, likening the current moment of resistance to the 19th century moment. The slogan was called Un Eterno Baragua. Baragua was a very important moment in the Cuban Wars of Independence where the rebels refused to surrender. And Fidel cast the current moment of the early 90s as the same kind of moment. The Soviet Union might surrender, but Cuba would not surrender. Cuba was an eternal Baragua, and eternal principled intransigence is something, might be a way to think about it. So it was the revolution's appeal to history and nationalism, as much as the strategic and ideological demands of the Cold War, that explains Cuba's troubled relationship with the United States after 1959. And I think this means two things. First, that burying the last remnants of the Cold War, as Obama said during his speech in Havana, is probably not sufficient to mending fences with Cuba. And second, that understanding this much longer history and the power of nationalism in Cuba are critically important to understanding both the revolution and Cuba's complex relationship to the United States. This is why for American leaders to talk so confidently about moving beyond the past can be a little treacherous. It ignores the centrality of a historical vision and a historical consciousness in Cuban political discourse for more than half a century. And it downplays the very real and within Cuba very well-known history of U.S. challenges to Cuban sovereignty. Okay, so beyond the question of the future relationship with the U.S. for Cuba, internally in Cuba, this is also a moment of profound uncertainty. Fidel obviously is no longer in power. During the Cuban Communist Party Congress last week, he talked about the fact that he would soon die, which he doesn't often talk about. It's much more, for a long time, he used to talk about himself and he was actually formerly the president of something called the 120 Club of people who live to be 120. He's striking a very different tone right now, and in that, he publicly said that it happens to all of us, I will soon die, and the future will continue. Anyway, so he's no longer in power, obviously, and likely not much longer for this world. Raul has announced that he will step down in 2018. And economic reforms in the last several years are changing aspects of economic and social life quite markedly. Amid change that has the potential to be profound, and at what feels like a very definite crossroads, Cuban history itself is up for grabs. So it's not just the history of Cuba and the U.S. that's being reinterpreted, it's also Cuban history itself. And the question of how the history of the Cuban Revolution will be understood, written and remembered, is clearly at stake. Now, the fact that the current opening is happening on the U.S. side under the presidency of Barack Obama puts in pronounced relief the question of the revolution's legacy for Cuba's complex history of race and racism. In his, and many of you, maybe you don't all know, but I have done, most of my work before this has dealt with issues of slavery and racism and anti-racism. So this is something I'm particularly interested in that I think is particularly salient in this moment. In Obama's televised speech at the Gran Teatro, Obama began by outlining the commonalities between the two countries. First on his list was the fact that, quote, we share the same blood, end quote. He then said something obvious but unprecedented in American presidential politics. He said, slavery built the U.S. That history, moreover, accounts for a fundamental commonality between Cuba and the U.S. He said, quote, we both live in a new world, colonized by Europeans. Cuba, like the United States, was built in part by slaves brought here from Africa. Like the United States, the Cuban people can trace their heritage to both slaves and slave owners, end quote. Thus, Obama presented a shared history of slavery and a shared sense of racial identity as common ground between the two countries. Obama returned to the question of race later in the speech and seemed to address Cubans of African descent explicitly. He said, quote, "We both realize," meaning Cuba and the U.S., "we both realize we have more work to do to promote equality in our countries, to reduce discrimination based on race in our own countries. And in Cuba, we want our engagement to help lift up Cubans who are of African descent," end quote. In a country in which political discourse rarely mentions race explicitly, and Cuban political discourse rarely mentions race explicitly, I'm happy to talk more about that later if you want in the question and answer. But in a country where race is not often talked about in politics, Obama seemed to be saying to Cubans of African descent, "I see you, and I understand your centrality in the past and future of your country." Could this be why Obama chose a black-owned restaurant to dine in with his family? The restaurant he chose is one of only about 4 or 5 out of more than 700 currently operating in Havana. The restaurant, called the San Cristobal, is located in Centro Havana, a neighborhood that is blacker, poorer, and significantly more dilapidated than the restored sections of Old Havana that he was guided through by the historian of the city, Eusebio Leal. A woman who lives across the street from the restaurant captured the arrival of President Obama and his family and his significant entourage on a video that went viral shortly after. And I'm going to see if I can play it. This is a homemade video, you know, shot by a woman, second floor, who lives across the restaurant where Obama and his family went. Let's see. Okay. All right, hold on. Well, I'm seeing it here, but it's not showing up there.
Vamos a ver cuál es el tipo ahora. ¿De dónde sale? Míralo ahí, mira la limusina a mí.
Yo creo que es también.
Pero todas son iguales, ¿no? Todas son iguales.
Señores, video that... y nos encontramos en el lugar privilegiado y okay. más comentado. De... Señora Raiza Pérez, su propietaria. Raiza, qué felicidad tener al presidente de los Estados Unidos en su casa. Después.
There you go.
All right. Apologies for that. Okay, so the as I was saying, that's him entering this restaurant, which is one of maybe four or five black-owned restaurants among 700 of these new private restaurants that have been cropping up for the last few decades, and exponentially in the last few years, and you heard the it's a homemade video. Obviously, you can hear in her cheering her emotional response to Obama. She's shouting out Obama. You hear people clapping in the background. She says in English at one point, "Oh my God!" Right? You all heard it. You laughed, and in the moment, you can almost hear the sense of connection between Obama and the people on that street. And in that moment, he seemed to become, as a colleague of mine, Ana de Pico, has suggested in another context, America's first Afro-Cuban president. It is perhaps telling that in Fidel Castro's published reflections on Obama's speech, the ones that I showed you the cover a little while ago, Fidel singled out Obama's take on race in Cuba. And Fidel wrote, quote, "Obama does not bother to say that racial discrimination was abolished by the revolution, that the salary and retirement of all Cubans was guaranteed by the revolution before Mr. Obama was yet 10 years old. He does not say that the odious, racist, and bourgeois practice of hiring henchmen to expel blacks from the social clubs was eliminated by the revolution," end quote. But for Fidel, the problem lies in that the people cheering Obama outside that restaurant know that, decrees notwithstanding, the problem of racism not only has not been solved, but actually gains new force in the economy that has been emerging since the start of Raul's reforms more than a decade ago. Moves towards privatization of parts of the economy has privileged those who already have access to capital, in the form of remittances from abroad, or apartments in good enough condition to rent out, and buildings in good enough condition to sell. I learned only recently that something like only about 45% of Havana housing meets minimum standards. So if you have access to currency from abroad, if you have a good house that you can rent out or you can sell in the private real estate market that has been emerging over the last few years, you have an enormous advantage over people who don't. And in this emerging private, increasingly private sector economy, often it's poorer Cubans and Afro-Cubans who don't have access to opportunity. And I think Cubans who were welcoming Obama on that street are well aware of that. Yet Fidel's reflections on Obama's take on race did not recognize this new reality, and instead seemed to return to an old notion that the revolution had conquered racism. Fidel Castro, initially the revolution addressed issues of racism, hesitantly, and then in 1962, Fidel declared that racism had been resolved. And in the aftermath of that, to talk about racism was seen as something that encouraged disunity and division. And in a sense, when in Fidel's reflection, when he says we have defeated racism, he seems to be returning to that old notion that the revolution had conquered racism. And he seemed to be suggesting, as has been the case historically, that there is no specific need in 2016 to bring up the question. While the specific topic here is race, at issue is a broader struggle over the legacy of the revolution, a struggle, again, over how to understand history. Obama's take on history in general emphasized moving past it, not being defined or trapped by it. Cuban critics, Fidel among them, chastised the naivete or the arrogance of that claim. History cannot, indeed should not, be forgotten. Yet when the topic turns specifically to questions about race, it is as if the earth shifts and each party assumes the stance of the other. So Obama talks about the significance of history, the significance of slavery and racism, and of the need to continue to struggle over its legacies. Fidel and the Cuban state, meanwhile, seem in that one particular area to want always to move past it, to not be defined by the past, and to look to the future as friends and family, to borrow Obama's language. So what might we conclude from this kind of mirrored divergence? Maybe that politicians invoke history when it is most convenient, and that they rush to get past it again when it most suits? In this moment, when, as I've said repeatedly, history itself is up for grabs, we need new histories, ones that encompass and give central and vital attention to relations between the two countries in both directions, that pay attention to ties of both solidarity and empire and hostility, and finally, that pay attention to the vital role of race and of Cubans of African descent in both the past, present, and as yet murky future that is emerging even as we speak. And this, of course, means, as I'm sure all the historians among us will agree, that our work as historians is of critical and utmost importance. That's it.
So now we move to our question section. Wait for the microphone to reach you before you begin to speak. Please identify yourselves when you get the microphone and use the microphone when you get it so everyone can hear. Yes, the microphone will reach you in a moment.
Thank you. I apologize for being late. I had it down for 4:30. I'm Mitzi Wertheim with the Naval Postgraduate School and was lucky enough to go with the first Peace Corps trip to Cuba last October. And to say it was wonderful is an understatement, but what I was struck by was the vitality, the energy that we felt, and how art and music, or at least in the cities, is so much a part of what goes on there. My question is, how are they going to manage this incredible influx? I read something in the New York Times yesterday. They have 112 flights daily coming in from the U.S. I mean, I would think Airbnb is going to do very well, because it's not clear to me that they have enough.
Airbnb.
Yeah. Sorry. To handle all these influx of folks. We also went to see some art schools of dance. I mean, art seems to be so much a part of what goes on there. So what is your sense? Oh, the other point that was made by one of our Peace Corps folks was how rich the soil appeared, and how if they got into really farming, how that could be a real export. So.
Yeah, so, I mean, there's a few questions there. In terms of how they're going to handle the influx, nobody knows. So there's not 115 flights a day yet, right? So that's what's expected, and that's what's been approved.
About banking and credit cards.
Okay. Okay. So there's not 115 flights yet a day, but there will be, you know, in the foreseeable future. How they're going to handle it? Nobody knows. If you go to the airport, there's hardly any luggage belts for the luggage. The runway is really short. I heard stories about, you know, the landing of Obama had all those big cars. You know, there's also all these big planes. It was really, there wasn't almost not enough runway for them to land. So there will have to be infrastructure projects. There are hotels being constructed. I saw at least three new ones, but even that won't be enough. And there's air. You know, I was there in March. You know, I was there for 3 weeks. So 2 weeks before Obama got there, 2.5 weeks before Obama got there, and then I stayed through his time there. All the Airbnbs were mostly booked. I couldn't find a place. I mean, the New York Times had a story maybe a week or two after Obama's trip that said something like, it's as if all the Americans are rushing to Cuba before the Americans rush to Cuba. And that's what it felt like. I've never seen as many American tourists as I did on this trip. And I had been there a year earlier in May during the Biennale, which is the big art festival every 2 years. And that trip seemed to me like Havana was full of Americans, but this past March was even much greater than that. So, you know, how they'll handle the one thing to think about, because in some sense they're not prepared to handle it right now. That you would have, it almost, in the scheme of things, it might have made more sense to undo some of the parts of the embargo first so that people might have had access to goods to build before the tourist influx. We'll see how that plays out. In terms of the energy and the arts, you're absolutely right. The revolutionary government from the beginning devoted a lot of attention to things like dance, classical music, folklore, and that tradition has continued. Though there's many celebrities who also look to leave, so there's also the people who defect and so on. But there's still a lot of attention devoted to it, and it'll be interesting to see what Americans go to Cuba, because it may not be the same Americans who want to do beach vacations elsewhere in the Caribbean. I'm not sure. It may be ultimately, but I think initially it'll be Americans more interested in that kind of cultural, artistic, and in a sense, you know, history-driven tourism. And what was your other question? Something about
credit cards and banking.
I mean, we can't use them. You can't use American credit. There's now one place apparently where you can use an American credit card, but right now, you can't. And for the first time ever, you know, I've been going to Cuba since 1990, and I go about once a year. There's a few years where I haven't gone. It was so much more expensive this trip that something happened to me that had never happened before. I ran out of money, and so I had to go. You know, I had to do Western Union and get cash that way. There's, you know, we still can't use the cash cards and credit cards, so.
Thank you.
But soon, apparently, yeah.
Right there in the back, and then we'll move to this side.
Hi, I'm Mitch Fulton, and I was in Cuba a couple weeks ago, and one of the things, after Obama's visit, and one of the things that my Cuban friends were talking a lot about was his accessibility and the fact that he, as you see in this picture here, he's without a tie. He arrived with his family. And Cubans were saying, well, you know, we've never seen Raul's family. We've never seen Fidel's family. So the fact that he came with his wife, his mother-in-law, his children, to them was a very big deal.
Yeah.
And his whole accessibility and the fact that I think in many ways they were saying he's much more popular than Fidel or Raul. Do you think that's certainly an issue that's at play right now?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I was really, I was there the whole time he was there, and I would talk to people on the street, and everyone used that word, used words like humble, accessible, kind, smart. They were just full of these positive adjectives for him. I heard there was, you know, on certain avenues, people would line up to see the motorcade, and I have a friend who saw, an older white woman, say in front of, to a policeman, say, oh, I'm going to get to see my president. And she was talking about Obama. And another friend watched the arrival, the landing of the plane at a bar in Centro Havana. Again, Centro Havana is kind of a popular neighborhood. It's that same one I showed you in that video. And he said that the moment when they landed, two things happened. One is that one man at the bar started clapping. And everyone in the bar turned and looked at him like, what are you doing? And he said something like, what? And then they all started clapping. And then the other thing is that the moment, it was raining, if you remember, when he arrived. And the first thing he did, you know, Obama had the umbrella, and he opened it and covered Michelle. And people were talking about that moment a lot as well, as this very kind of human, humble, thoughtful moment. So I would say that just like on the ground, people I talked to, they were overwhelmingly positive. Without a doubt. And people did ask me, oh, he can't run for president again? You know, people, that came up, you know, why can't he run? And someone said, oh, you don't do that there. And then someone thought about it and said, oh, that's what's good and bad about your system, which I thought was kind of an interesting take on it. But so in some sense, the kind of the response on the ground has been overwhelmingly positive. But there has been this kind of official response in the press, and you got a sense of it in the parts that I read from Fidel's speech and that other speech where, you know, it said, oh, Obama will be forgotten, right? And in the... And in the, I think it was last week, the foreign minister likened the Obama's visit to an attack. Because I think in some sense they're disconcerted by how popular he was there. And maybe have a feeling that they won't be able to quite kind of manage it all. But we'll see.
Right next to you.
Yeah, so I actually want to follow up on that, what you were saying, because I think it's a really interesting thing, because your analysis and your presentation was mostly about kind of the government-to-government relations, yeah. Right? It was Obama says this, Fidel said this, yeah. and of course that's a big part of it, but there's also this difference that it's kind of exposing this disconnect between the Cuban government and the Cuban people that, of course, probably has always been there, but it's you can't poll it. You don't know what it actually is. So you now they may actually be seeing this and feeling this, and I think it's not just, of course, Obama and the U.S. government. It's just going to be so many more Americans, so much more openness, so much more investment. Could they lose control of this thing? I think they could, and kind of what's the next thing, you know? There's no real good history historical analogy on this, right? Or is there? You know, are they going to lose control, and then what? Do they do a, you know, who knows?
Yeah, it's an interesting question. I don't know what next. I don't know. But the question about is there a good historical analogy for this, I'm not sure that there is. And I hate to be one of those people who thinks that Cuban history is exceptional. I don't really think that. But I think the connection between Cuba has been so close historically. And then it was so hostile for these 50 years. And to have it so suddenly thrown up and become open again is something unprecedented. I can't think of any other example like that. My sense is that they obviously don't want to lose control of it. But I think they can't seem to control kind of popular opinion about it right now. And popular opinion doesn't necessarily believe, I don't think it believes the state line that Obama's visit was an attack. I think it just simply doesn't. So we'll see. But the thing is, it's still playing out, right? There's still, those speeches were just made last week. So it's almost like they want to keep saying it, see if they can shape public opinion, but as far, I don't think that they are.
Yeah. Okay. The lady up front here to the left. And the
thank you very much, Dr. Ferrer. My name is Alexandra Galbard. I'm a sociologist, and I've been working in Cuba for the last 14 years, mm-hmm. primarily in Oriente and Santiago. Mm-hmm. I've used your work a lot, so thank you for that. I will preface my question by saying that I situate my research and analysis within an African diaspora perspective, mm-hmm. Centering the African presence in Cuba and the Americas as part of how the experience of oppression in the diaspora reveals about how humans respond under those conditions and the resilience of humanity and personhood. Cuba has been an incredible space in order to examine that. And throughout the histories, the interlinked histories between the U.S. and Cuba, one aspect that kind of undergirds your presentation today has been the connectivity across diaspora liberation movements, mm-hmm. Both throughout history, but as well as contemporarily. As Cuba, now because of the UN declaration of the decade of peoples of African descent, has that has invigorated a lot of scholarship on the African presence in Cuba, it has, you know, forced them to engage in the race question and really also talk about the Partido Independiente de Color, mm-hmm. and the massacre. So given that those two, and as well as in the U.S., as we address, you know, this current wave of addressing, you know, black liberation movements, particularly through Black Lives Matter, the connectivity across Cuba and the U.S. regarding how colorblind racism functions in both societies, the distinctions and commonalities, provide some really interesting frames of analysis. So amidst all of these talks and lectures on normalizing relations, I'm curious to see what your take on what does the normalization of relations actually mean? What is normal about relations? And if in history that has been problematic, how can we move forward to creating a new normality?
Okay. Quick question. Yeah,
I mean, what's normal? I mean, what exists now isn't normal. That's for sure, right? The fact that that we're 90 miles away and people can't travel back and forth, that you can't, you know, in either direction. So, so I think part of the normalization would be, yeah. I mean, there's so many pieces to it, right? So there's the travel piece, right? That Americans would get to travel. Right now, Cubans no longer require, the Cuban government no longer requires an exit permission to exit the country. So Cubans can travel, assuming they could pay for a ticket, et cetera. So that would be one stream of normalization. Another would be being able to spend money in Cuba, which you can't do right now. Would normalization also mean, for example, changing immigration law in the U.S., right? Because right now, Cubans who come in get a credit towards nationality and a credit towards citizenship that no other group gets, right? So Cubans now are leaving. They're flying to Ecuador because it's easier to get a visa there, and then they're traveling, you know, by land and entering at the Mexico-U.S. border, where they just announce that they're Cuban and they're allowed in. And meanwhile, Mexicans and Central Americans are treated very, very differently. So I think everyone assumes that that is something that will probably change under normalization. Beyond, I mean, your question about kind of the African African diaspora, I think one, and I. You know, I think for so you it sounds like you've read some of my work, and for those of you who haven't, in my work, which is mostly 19th century and late 18th, I make questions of race and slavery central to broader Cuban histories. I think that hasn't been done for the period of the revolution. There are studies, there are some examples, but in terms of, you know, there's a way that can be made central to the study of the Cuban Revolution. And it's something that's usually left out of the in these discussions of normalization. But I think that, you know, Obama himself in his speech seemed to signal to it, right? In I think a humble way, acknowledging kind of problems in the U.S. that you're referring to. But yeah, that's not really much of an answer. But there you have it.
Could I perhaps use the prerogative of a share to? Follow up on these questions. One is certainly on the American side of writing the Cuban history and the Cuban American history. Cuban Americans mm-hmm. have been an important voice and had an important mm-hmm. role. How do you see that role mm-hmm. evolving politically and historically? Mm-hmm. And then secondly, you know, you started your presentation by focusing on the Cuban-American relationship, and I like this term intimacy that you used, and certainly something to think more about. And then you moved to the race issue, which is where your historical work has been. But mm-hmm. do you see that? I'm just curious, not being a Cuba expert at all, do you see that as a central question for Cuba today and mm-hmm. for the relationship?
Mm-hmm. So first on the Cuban-American question, I should say I was born in Cuba. I'm Cuban-American, just full disclosure. I do think that it's an important part. I always tell my students who want to work on Cuba, and they try to get their tickets through Toronto and Montreal and the Bahamas. I say, no, you have to go through Miami. You will not understand Cuba unless you do the trip from Miami to Havana. You have it's not sufficient to understand Cuba, but it's a prerequisite. I think Cuban Americans in the U.S. have been important, obviously, in national politics, in determining U.S. policy towards Cuba. There's been a generational shift, obviously, but it's not just a we tend to think of the generational shift as there was this old guard that came in the early 60s, and they've grown old and died, and their children and grandchildren are less inflexible. That's usually the way we think about the generational shift. To me, more important, I think, is that you've had a constant stream of Cubans coming in different waves, and that many, many Cubans have come in since the 1990s. And these are Cubans who have mostly didn't know Cuba before the revolution, right? So they've grown up in the revolution, they've been educated by the revolution, and they have a very different take than the old guard. So that's a different kind of generational shift that's occurred that's really important. And for the most part, those Cubans have a lot of family left in Cuba. They're very interested in establishing ties. They're less ideologically driven, and I think that's part of what makes possible this change that Obama's putting in place. I also think the question is important. Just thinking about the Cuban Revolution, many, many Cubans have left, right? There's there's over a million in the U.S. For Cubans in Cuba, there is kind of recurring thinking about whether to leave or whether to stay. And when you talk to young people in Cuba, they all know people who are leaving or trying to leave, or they're thinking about leaving. So it's almost like leaving is a constant presence in the U.S. There's a famous poet in Cuba who used to run this workshop in a rooftop space in the 1990s, and so many of her colleagues were leaving that she would put up a photo of everyone who left. And it came to a point where there were more photos than people present. So I do think that thinking about Cuban Americans, you can think about it both ways, in the way it impacts U.S. policy, but even in the way it impacts Cuba itself, and how so many people have a connection to people who've left and people think about leaving. In terms of race, I do think that it's absolutely absolutely central. The majority of Cuba is more than half black. So the whatever transition happens, they will be the largest group experiencing it. Cubans of color, historically in the revolution, achieved gains, especially through the 1990s, right? Because if you think about the early gains of the Cuban Revolution, mostly in areas like education and healthcare, and then you study data on life, things like life expectancy or average years of schooling, you can see that after the situation of Afro-Cubans improved from 1959 to, say, 1990. Right? But then after the special period begins, which is the period of economic crisis after the Soviet Union collapses, and when you begin to get kind of a return of some private forms, the beginning of tourism, et cetera, there you had kind of blacks begin to decline again. And that has been the case for the last 20 or so years, right? So suddenly, for example, like when I first started going to Cuba in 1990 and I stayed in a hotel, most of the staff was black. Right? By 1999, a hotel job was really something sought after because it gave you access to tourists, to hard currency. By the late 90s, most of the staff at that hotel was white. Right? So you saw this reversal happen in the 90s and early 2000s. And so now, when there's not the beginning, but the pace of privatization is accelerating, it seems to me that the government will have to do something that explicitly targets Afro-Cubans. Otherwise, they're going to get left more behind, right? So I do think it's a critical issue right now.
I want to slip in a question, if I may. And you cite Fidel Castro and Barack Obama, both invoking history, albeit in very different ways. Political figures aren't historians, and they use what history is convenient for them, though I would think that Obama actually gets a better grade in his use of history than most American presidents. You also said that the Cuban history itself will be up for grabs. There'll be a struggle over the legacy of the revolution in the years to come. If you step back from what politicians say, they are politicians, to what historians say, would I be correct in thinking that U.S.-based historians of Cuba, who do not follow a U.S. government line, in fact, interpret the revolution in a kind of a multifaceted way, that the Cuban historians, would I be wrong in thinking, don't do that as much? And so where is the struggle going to take place? Are U.S.-based historians going to reinterpret the revolution? And if so, how? Or is this really about how Cubans themselves, not the government, but Cuban academics, how they will reinterpret the revolution?
Well, I mean, it'll be both. But the thing about Cuban history and Cuban academics is maybe because TV is not private yet, you have Cuban historians on Cuban television all the time talking about this stuff. It's not like the U.S. where you have academics in the, you know, in their classroom and
you know. But you can watch us on the National History Center website.
Yes, great. So you know, every time I turn on the TV in Cuba, there's like five historians I know on there talking about stuff. So I do think, I mean, there's like a couple of things that I think that there has been, given the significance of the Cuban Revolution, right, which I think clearly you can call one of the most radical revolutions of the 20th century, right? It completely upended hemispheric relations. It destroyed the ruling class. It created a completely new economic system. I think there's no doubt about that. Whether you judge that in a positive or negative light, the fact that it is a radical revolution that produces profound change is indisputable. So, but given that significance, I think that there is remarkably little history written about it. So for the most part, the Cuban Revolution has been interpreted by political scientists and economists and sociologists, even by literary critics. But historians, there's been some work, in part because, but not as much as you would think, in part because of difficulty of archives, difficulty of access. The fact that, you know, that it wasn't that long ago, in some sense, if you... There's that famous Chinese saying about the French Revolution not being old enough yet for us to assess its legacy. So there is that. In terms of how it will be reexamined, I do think American historians will do that. I think Cuban historians will as well. Cuban historians, for the most part, have avoided the Cuban Revolution. So I think the best historical work in Cuba, right, that's not kind of ideologically driven and that kind of assumes an official state line, right? The best history of that kind, in part because it doesn't want to adopt that line, looks for other topics. So it's mostly written about the 19th century or the early 20th century. It avoids the kind of very highly politicized history. But at the same time, I know colleagues who have, you know, they have projects they work on that they've never published. They have manuscripts in their drawers. They're interested in this. So I think it'll happen on both sides. And I don't think it'll just be academic historians. I think it'll be public and, you know, public intellectuals. It'll be, you know, statesmen and women. It'll be, you know, news anchors.
Okay, good. We'll go Will first, back in the left there, yeah. And then we'll go to the gentleman up here, and I'll say right now.
Will Amatruda, speaking as someone who first became aware of the Amistad incident in 1954 when I was in grade school, thanks to a display at the New Haven Public Library of the Hale Woodruff mural, I'm curious how the Amistad affair has been treated in Cuba both before 1959 and since.
Before 1959, I'm not sure. There's really interesting work being done on the Amistad by Cuban scholars. And one of the things that they have focused on is the ties between American slave traders and Cuban traders an African factor. I mean, both, yeah, and people on the African coast selling Africans. So one, I mean, it's a long, complicated story, but the bottom line is that one of the things that their work has shown is that as opposed to the usual American story, where the Americans enter the Amistad case to liberate the captives, right? That's the Supreme Court decision. In the Cuban, in the new work that's being done on Cuba, you have Americans actually on the African coast participating in their enslavement, which is kind of an interesting and important corrective, I think.
Thank you. Pete up front here.
And I can give you some references if you want to look them up later.
Thank you. My name is John Cloud. I'm a historian at NOAA, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration. And just to bring up something that hasn't been discussed yet, NOAA right now and Cuba are working on these memorandums of understanding very rapidly mm-hmm. about coastal and oceanic reserves and how to strengthen and support them. I mean, the monoculture sugar cultivation on the land has had one set of consequences, but the flip side of that is that there's been relatively little coastal development, and there's a very exemplary system of ecological reserves and protected coral reefs and so on. And it is considered on both sides by the sort of environmental ecological community of Cuba and the United States about this stuff that this is not going to last very long, and there's a race against time to try to get something in place to reinforce protected ocean and coastal areas before the inevitable decline sets in, as you can see everywhere else in the Caribbean and the Gulf of Mexico. Mm-hmm. So I wonder if you know, this is just one little part of that puzzle about what's going to happen ecologically to Cuba. We've talked thus far primarily about political and social things, but do you have any things to say about that?
I mean, there's so many questions like that, right? That there's the coast. What's going to happen? What's going to happen to agriculture? Even what's going to happen to architecture? Which may, you know, right? That there have been projects to restore and maintain crumbling buildings, but I don't, you know, but really in a tiny little pocket of Havana. Right, in Old Havana, if you go to Centro Havana, it's just dilapidated, and there haven't been projects there. And so the question is, well, does it all get demolished? And then what takes its place? Is any of it salvageable? And I think, you know, I don't have the answer to that, but what I think is happening is that there are, in the same way that you're involved in one for the coast, I know people who are involved in ones for architecture in the city, and I think there's, so I think in some sense it's groups like yours in collaboration with the Cubans that'll have the answers. But my sense from talking to people is that kind of collaboration is happening in almost every area. So in the race against time, that's a little helpful at least.
Thank you very much, Benjamin Tour, retired diplomat. My question concerns the significance of the two very different presidential visits to Cuba, the 1928 visit mm-hmm. and President mm-hmm. Obama's. What motivated President Coolidge to mm-hmm. visit at that time? And what was the meaning of his visit? And regarding President Obama's visit, while tremendously important, is there a danger that we might be viewing this a little bit too U.S.-centric way? After all, there are many other, Cuba's open to everybody now. And there are many other countries with very close ties to Cuba, mm-hmm. the Spaniards, others who would be very interested, the French, the right. Germans, the Russians, the
Canadians.
Chinese, Canadians, Indians, and so on. Could you speak about that, because that also would seem to be making a tremendous difference in infrastructure building and so on and so mm-hmm. forth. Thank you.
So Coolidge was there in 1928 before he opened up a meeting of the Organization of American States, the Pan-American Congress. It was a very different moment, obviously, in U.S. Cuban relations. The Platt Amendment was still in place. The Platt Amendment, as some of you, or maybe all of you know, was put in place before the Americans evacuated in 1902, and it gave the U.S. the right to intervene to protect its interests. And I mean, it stipulated several, there were five different conditions under which the U.S. could intervene. So the Platt Amendment was still in place. It was very much the visit of an American president, of a president at the head of an American state that had all kinds of power, very obvious power over Cuba. So, you know, very different. They were, you know, they finished the Monument to the Maine in part to receive him, so, and they had a ceremony. But I think almost nothing like it in a sense, right? That. Right, but now, I mean, Obama's coming in, obviously, after it's almost the opposite, right? Coolidge came in when the two governments were really close, but in this hard, you know, in this really uneven, uneven power-laden relationship, and Obama's coming in under very different circumstances. In terms of comparing it to other countries that also have ties to the U.S., you know, as you said, you know, Canada, France, Spain, Mexico, all these governments have close ties to Cuba. The U.S. is not the only president who's visited lately. But it is interesting that once Obama and Raul announced the path to normalization, or the beginning of a path to normalization, the number of foreign presidents seeking to visit Cuba also grew exponentially. So in some sense, Obama and Raul's opening also paved the way for more people to visit. So, you know, those other ties are there, but I still think that, and you can see it in terms of the response of the Cuban people. The Cuban people have not responded to any of those other presidents the way they have responded to Obama. I mean, it'd be interesting, I mean, you know, comparing Obama to the Pope, and since I wasn't there when the Pope visited, but that would be kind of, that was something of comparable magnitude. And I do think it's a reflection of just, of first, how close the two countries were before this, how close they are in some ways due to people-to-people ties, the fact that so many Cubans have family in the U.S., right? And the fact that officially there's been such a hostile relationship for so long. So I don't, you know, that is unusual and I think gave the visit a different kind of character.
Thank you. Irina?
Thank you. Marina Ottawa with the Wilson Center. In the context of how the people are going to handle all these changes, can you tell us something about the age of the population? Is this a country with a high birth rate and therefore a very young population, a country with a low birth rate and therefore an aging population?
I don't have the figures with me, but it's an aging population.
It's an aging
and a relatively
population.
Low
okay.
birth rate, yeah. Yeah.
It's interesting.
What's that? 75% of the Cuban youth generation, so under 40.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. We have time for one or two more questions then down here.
Beth Marcus, with no affiliation other than I'm a volunteer docent at the National Archives, where we have on display a facsimile of a letter from a very good English writer of 12 years old to FDR, congratulating him on his 1940 re-election and asking him to send him a $10 green American bill.
Yeah.
We have no record. He said, because never have I seen one. That's about $150 today. We have no record that he ever got it sent, which I tell my people on my tour, maybe things would have been different. But the question I have is that Cuba has so influenced other countries. And I don't just mean Angola. I'm talking about Central and South America particularly. Right. I'm curious if you have any insight or thoughts about how, as the U.S. relationship strengthens, what impact that might have on the role and the feelings of the other countries towards us.
Thank you. Towards the U.S.
Well, yeah. I mean, with Cuba's relationship with the United States changing, do you think that will have a change in any other way impact with Central and South American countries?
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think that was definitely part of Obama's motivation in doing this. It wasn't just about normalizing relations with Cuba, but I think he realized that U.S. policy not only had it failed and that it hadn't produced what the Americans had set out to produce at the beginning, right? It hadn't changed the Cuban government. It hadn't opened up Cuba. He knew it, that American policy created that failure. But he also understood that American policy created another failure, and that is that it isolated the U.S. in the hemisphere and actually in the world. So I think part of changing the policy was part of the motivation was in dismantling that that American isolation. And I do think that it will help in that regard. But I think it's still, I mean, it's still, you know, as historians always say, too soon to tell. Yeah, yeah. But that's his hope. Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Final question over there, and then we'll close it.
And this is a quick question, because I was part of the direct mail project. As a matter of fact, I held the letter that and put it on the airplane that I was going to Cuba as part of the project. By the way,
could you introduce yourself by name?
I forgot. Jimmy Ortiz from the Postal Service.
Thank you.
We had coverage of this letter here and the nightly news and stuff like that, but I haven't gotten a reaction if it was either covered or what was the reaction to that lady getting that letter from the President of the United States. Did you hear anything about that?
No, I didn't hear anything about the lady specifically, but the arrival was definitely covered on Cuban news, yes. And the letter was mentioned, but I haven't seen any follow-up with her, yeah. Congratulations.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah.
That was a
hard-fought
thing. Yeah, yeah. Well, with that, we will draw our session to a close. Before you depart, let me just say there'll be a reception outside these doors, so please join us for that. Please come back next week when Jeffrey Herf of the University of Maryland will present on his new book, Undeclared Wars with Israel, East Germany, and the West German Far Left, 1967 to 1989. Thank you to our audience for being here today, and thank you to Ada Ferrer.